Greetings in the name of the Most High. I will try, seriously, not to digress. Not the wee hours. We were involved in researching the great split, and it's so fascinating to me, the debates. Anyway, Zeph Daniel here, the Zeph Daniel podcast called The Zeph Report, and many new people recently tuning in, and so from wherever, most of you come from YouTube, from bros out there, sisters that post us on video, and a lot of you, that's fine, you stay there in the video realm. I know that someone was saying, well, you got 1.5 million plays on 1,300 episodes. Well, that's Pod Bean, that goes back to 2008. And it isn't that many views, really, when you think about it. But if you add in the YouTubes out there and all the other places we are blogged, then it actually comes out to be a, you know, fairly substantial number for a small broadcast. And we are a niche broadcast. We basically are... I'm going to be tired today. I basically appeal to at most about 10% of the population. And you know who you are. At most. And more typically, perhaps about 5% of the population. In other words, I'm dealing with a very special group of the population who are in special circumstances of the population, in that they're either awake and they want to know, okay, well, I'm awake, now what? And to which I would say, are you really? We deal with... It's funny, the word I had on computer 2.9 never really got developed completely. It did in podcasts that you didn't hear, because apparently I said something or did something in the podcast that was... the Lord edits me, okay? I have faith from the very beginning. There may be, you know, I'm liable to say anything. You know, so the problem is to get in and try to, you know, ride the wave if there's something happening until it ends, and then get out before going in a direction that could compromise the good part of the podcast. And I've noticed that I've done that. I've shot myself in the foot that way probably. Well, it's a good thing that I don't just broadcast every day live from a studio, because if I did and something needed to be edited, well, oh well, it's not going to be. And, you know, so I do believe there's good quality control here. I've dedicated this to the Lord God Almighty, the creator of heaven and earth, to Jesus Christ, the one, Yeshua HaMashiach, the one that, I mean, I dance with the one who brung me. You're welcome from any other religion or non-religion. I got friends from all kinds of walks of life, including, you know, those who don't know what God is or to have no experience or no, they got a feeling, but they're not quite sure. Ranging to people from Hindus to Jews to various, you know, they all are welcome here. We don't, you know, there is no, you know, I just ask you to accept my, you know, me dancing with the one who brung me. You know what I mean? I just ask you to, okay, so you want to tune in here, then, you know, and we talk about lots of things. But you'll accept my, it's not a buy it, but my belief. And you don't have to believe the way that I do, because I'm not doing what the church does here. You don't have to believe the way I do, because I understand that it's all to be given to the Lord, that the Lord will guide. God will guide, okay? And so if he's got you and he's guiding you, you know, your all knowledge ends up being the same. And to all of us who are guided, we end up having the same conversation anyway. So there's, unless people fight it, and if you fight it, then, you know, I've ministered to some people. I say the word minister with quotes on it. When they have had idolatry with the Bible, that's been a real problem in the church. Just like, for example, the connection of the Catholic Church to witchcraft and to, black magic and the dark arts. Those two seem to have gone hand in hand. A lot of people coming out of that dark tradition. And, there's no such thing as secular witches. All witches believe in God because they have to turn against God to do the bidding of the one, you know. And if they don't know that about themselves, then they are limited in their knowledge of witchcraft, because it depends on, you know, it largely for Western witchcraft, which is what we deal with here. It deals exclusively with the Christian religion and the Judeo-Christian tradition, because most of the rituals and everything that kind of comes out of it is a reaction to or in dealing with that culture. Now, I'm very familiar with other cultures. For example, Eastern culture, there's the same amount of witches everywhere. Doesn't matter what the religion is. And it's usually, in the case of Hinduism, it's kind of incorporated. I mean, the people that could be practicing witchcraft in Hinduism, which would be called the left-handed path in Hinduism, it wouldn't be separate, because Hindu is not a dualistic religion. It's it's monism. You know, it's a single thing that is like a big tent that includes all kinds of things. I mean, it can be very confusing to a Westerner studying it. And studying, I would suggest learning, ancient Sanskrit to really get some of the meanings of the word. I mean, I used to study that, but I don't any longer, because I don't read those texts in the. But they're very beautiful. They're very beautiful, the understanding of the one God. It's just that it's occluded to the West, so the West thinks it's a polytheistic religion, when indeed Hinduism is anything but that. It is a monist. It's more focused on one God than even the West, where we have the devil playing the part of, and evil playing the part of, almost like a separate character in a drama. So in Hinduism, God made everything, including the light, the dark, the good, the bad, and the ugly. I mean, everything. You see, in the West, we have to get to that point. And the Zeph Report here, we do, and again, this is for new listeners, we do get to that point where we connect the dots, because we know for a fact that God does not stand separate from Satan, that God created Satan, you don't have, and yes, Satan, witchcraft, Lucifer, witchcraft, whatever, it's all together. Those who deny that, you know, there's all kinds of games out there, but the one thing you need to know about witchcraft is, the rule number one is to remain undetected. So they're in our society, they're in your workplace, they're in your churches, they're in your fellowships, they're in your social life, and they're sometimes cleaning your house, whatever. They're all around, you know. It's the Lord has to find a way through that, because they can do quite huge damage to people. And usually when there's a practice that's self-oriented, as witchcraft is, they tend to do spells and things that they want to see, or that they want for themselves. And so it's a very selfish religion, if you will. They go, well, it's much older than Christianity. Well, it goes all the way back to the beginning, you know, to the book of Genesis, if you will, if you want to go that way. But it's been there from the beginning, and so has God. God is not separate from all of it. God created it all, including Satan. Now, the thing about Satan is, and the most salient thing, is that Satan can do nothing that the Lord doesn't want him to do. Obviously, the Lord has the hearts and minds and reins of everything that goes on. So the problem of evil goes back to the Lord. Isaiah 45, I am the Lord, I've created good and evil. You know, I'll create the tempest and the storm or the calm seas. You know, it's the Lord is really in charge of all that. So ultimately, the Judeo-Christian or dualistic tradition of monotheism, it's monotheism, but with evil that ends up being separate from God, that God cannot do evil, God cannot sin, God can't even look on sin. So what the church has done is ending up separate, making a split in human consciousness, so that evil is over here and God doesn't know what's going on, and then good is over here with God, and that God is just crying every day because of these evil people doing evil things, and we are the people that need to go rescue the people doing evil, take them away from the devil, and help deliver their souls to the Lord where they can be saved. And that's just a very incorrect, totally incorrect concept. And I know why it's taught from the church perspective, because the churches have always been money grubbing and power grubbing. And that gives the maximum power to the church, obviously, because the church is the intercessor between good and evil and has to intercede on evil to save God. And meanwhile, God is hamstrung somewhere just waiting for his servants to do good so he can be happy. Of course, that's ridiculous. And man has no such responsibility upon this earth, none. We are not to do the things God can't do for himself. So God can look upon sin. He can look upon evil. He manages the light and the dark and the equilibrium in between. I told you we always go back to equilibrium, and we're enjoying that right now, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you, those of you who followed here for a while, you understand equilibrium and what that means. In a state of equilibrium, you know, you're going to have good, you're going to have evil, you're going to have light, you're going to have dark, but they're in balance, where one is not necessarily going to wipe the other one out. I see so many Christian ministers talking about winning the world for Jesus, tying up the darkness so it's just all light. And it's like, well, if it's all light, dude, you're really in another dimension. It's not even, has nothing to do with this dimension. In this dimension, there's light and dark, there's life and death, there's there's a unity and a collision of opposites here, and there's equilibrium, and then there's chaos. Okay, now as I watch the human comedy unfolding, I see that most people are unaware of so many things. That the tragedy for me is the same tragedy it was for Jesus, but in the day where he said, look, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, I would save you all, but you wouldn't let me. My people perish due to what? What did he say? Ignorance. And the word in the Greek is really, you know, it's also lack of knowledge, yes, but the word in the Greek really goes more toward blindness, pride, self-willed pride causing blindness. It's more in that context, okay? It's like you've willed yourself. You're not ignorant. You don't have lack of knowledge. Man doesn't have to come save you by reading you the scriptures. I mean, that's another ridiculous thing. In those days, they had no such luxury. It's the knowledge that you possess that you've denied, in a sense. So it should read, my people perish due to self-willed ignorance, or due to self-willed blindness, or due to psychological denial, or due to simply pride. They don't want to admit they're wrong. They don't want to admit there is a Messiah. They don't want to admit, you know, and they, you know, will look at the scriptures and go, well, what good thing can come out of Bethlehem or Nazareth, and then, of course, be born in Bethlehem and then come from Nazareth, and then all the other things that had to happen for the prophecy to hold. And, you know, the people just didn't believe it, most of them. But here was Christ doing the miracles, doing things no man could do. And it just freaked the religious establishment out. So they did what was prophesied and predicted they would do. The lamb without spot. the lamb without blemish was to be sacrificed. And in so doing, they, if you will, screwed themselves, obviously, but they lost. And what won, what triumphed in the sacrifice of Jesus, what triumphed is the light, the true way, the way, the truth, and the light, and the life. Actually, John 14:6 says the life, the way, the truth, and the life, but I like to say light too, because in John 1 it says he's the true light that's the light of men, which then is another allusion to the fact that his real identity is Yahweh, Lord God Almighty, the creator of all things. He was a lamb slain from the foundation of the earth, who created the earth and everything in the cosmos, and came into life and was not recognized by his own. But such had to be the way to save humanity, because of a decision, if you will, an abrogation, a corruption that occurred that affected all the generations from a certain point. And that corruption is as much a physical corruption as a spiritual corruption, but it overturns it. And then it points the way to what's called the end times, which is the wrap-up. We're not always going to have this time-space continuum as we do here. We who are in time must escape time and space in order to live. Time and space is a death sentence. It's important for you to understand that. Whatever you think about the New World Order or this or that or World War III or however they're going to come get you, you're already got a death sentence on you, because you cannot escape this matrix. And even if you do manage to die, which you will, I assure you, my friend, when you're young, when I was young, I didn't think I was never going to die, right? So that's probably how you are. But here's the thing, when you do die, and sometimes it could be suddenly, just unexpectedly, you have to realize that salvation really means escaping this, you know, this conundrum that we're in, this recycling, this spin cycle, time-space continuum, and getting out beyond that, which is ultra-dimensional, which is also referred to as the New Jerusalem, okay? And which, oddly enough, is a cube. And then they say, well, Saturn, you're trapped in the cube. No, I think the cube in this is a way of describing, it just happens to be a cube, but it's a way of describing. It's interesting, we have now UFO sightings, they're now cubes. Cubes are flying around. And this has been the UFO summer, by the way. Yeah, and it's, you know, you may not have followed it, but I have. And there's a lot going on that wasn't going on the last, you know, been pretty quiet for the last few years. Seems now this summer it's ramping up. But it's okay. You know, we've had flaps before. Usually they prelude wars. They prelude, you know, disasters and things like that. So if you start seeing a lot of them around, they're just here to watch you suffer. Because they get off on that. Yeah, well, that's demonology. That's the demons. That's the whole world of Satan, the whole world of the occult. And I know that those of you who have been in it, you know, we understand, you know what I mean? It's like another life over there on the other side. But it is the side of death and the side of dreams. And dreams are dimensions, and they control us through dreams. A lot of the time when we think we're waking and having a life, it's really more a dream that's being controlled, but we think it's contiguous, and we think we're in charge of it when we're not at all. And it's just important to understand that distinction, so that if you begin to see the world you live in for what it really is, then you recognize the need for salvation 1,000% more, because you realize you're adrift. You can't solve it, and you can't just go die, because the first thing you're going to see are the aliens, first of all, when you die. This is Zeph's Book of the Dead now. So we're opening the Book of the Dead to page 1. You see the aliens when you're getting near death and in the twilight of your life, when you're passing away, and you just haven't left this world, but you're between the two. As you're going, you start seeing the aliens coming around, right? It's kind of like what people experience with DMT. Is it called DMT? What is that drug called? I think it was, someone was explaining to me, they call it the little death because you're able to have a glimpse of what it is at death. I'd say, yes, that's very accurate, calling it the little death, because I know people that have gone to the other side, to death, and they see the aliens. And that's what you see with this DMT thing. I think it lasts a couple of minutes, but you're in the experience may seem like you've been there an hour, because you're out, you're leaving time, the space, the crushing continuum of time, space, and gravity, which is a holds us here in place and keeps us in this prison. And you know, you recognize that you know, this after a while. I mean, other cultures seem to know it better than you, but I mean, you know, we understand the life is suffering, even on your best day. You know, I was seeing some rock stars regards this debate, and who was it? It was like Steven Tyler of Aerosmith, and Aerosmith. They were going to the debates. They're gonna go ahead and go check out the debates of the Republicans. Oh, yes, I know. You think most rock stars are liberals? Well, for a while, they might start off that way, but they don't end up that way. Tyler et al. Recognizes probably that if we continue down this road, you know, it's not good for rock stars. It's not good for anybody. But I was noticing in the picture that, and I'd seen pictures of him before, you know, just more modern ones. And you know, he's, you know, getting older, obviously, and now has a mustache. And, you know, lines. And it's just like, you know, it's like we're, that's right, we're all going together. You know, we're all going together. We have that in common. The wise man and the fool are the same in death. The rock star and the common man are the same in death. And the same thing goes with having concerns for the country. So they're, you know, I would say the next thing that Tyler et al. Will understand is, if they don't already, which is that God, it's all about God. It has to be. We have to fully rely on the Lord to get to recognize the situation we're in, and recognize we need help, and recognize how helpless we are. And then we must understand there is one who is not helpless, and that he will help us. That's the Lord God Almighty. I mean, I cannot even imagine being today in the world, in the stresses and pressures that there are today, without a really, really strong relationship with the Lord God, with Jesus Christ Almighty, you know. And people make fun of Jesus, and they go with a historical dashboard Jesus and all that. They don't understand the mystery of Christ is Yahweh. They don't understand it all. It's if you say you believe in God, and I say I believe in God, we can just leave it at that if we like. I define it a little more, because I dance with the one who brung me, you know, as I told you. You know, why would I, right? The Bible was by a guy who was in an apostate church system, you know, a 501c3. He put a Bible in my hand right at the time the Lord was lifting me up. He just, boom, there I was. And so it's like, okay, Lord, I got it, you know. So I went, because I'd been on a search. I'd read all the Hindu scriptures, a lot of the Buddhist sutras and histories and fables, and there's all kinds of stuff with Buddhism. It goes way back, but there's also the three temptations and the similar things about Jesus' life. Well, when people say that Jesus is a myth and they point out these similarities between the Buddha and Jesus and all that, I just say, look, I just have to set a lot of that aside. Or the teachings of Lao Tzu that went on 500 years before Jesus, and then they want to gloat over that. Here's my answer to that. As far as Lao Tzu, wonderful writings, wonderful, you know, things that he did. The writings don't save you, but there's wonderful wisdom there. And they say, well, you know, well, that's 500 years before Jesus. What do you have to say about that, Zaf? And my answer to that is, yes, well, you know, before Abraham was, I am. So you see, it didn't supersede Jesus, because Jesus is Yahweh. Jesus is the creator. Lao Tzu, he, you know, I felt like saying, who do you think made Lao Tzu, you dummy? It's Jesus. Let's go do but the true identity of Jesus is Yahweh. But then he said, well, what do you have to say about this? Jesus prays to the Father. Yes, Yes, and then you say, how could he be Yahweh? And the confusion there, it's because there's a mystery there that only God will let you understand. He has let me understand. I'm explaining it to you. There is no, my understanding will never change because it is the truth, period. It's evident in the scriptures. There is no argument. It's just that man's logic cannot fathom it. So he tends to want to do things he can understand, like paint by the numbers or whatever he does. And I don't mean to sound arrogant about man, but man's pretty, you know, if I don't understand it, it doesn't exist. Oh, okay, fine, you know. Yeah, think that way when you need me to pray over you, okay? When it's just so bad you can't stand it, where we just got to pray. And we're done with logic here. We're done with our own understanding. We just need the Lord. On that day, by the way, it really doesn't matter whether you have division of, you know, Father, Son, Holy Spirit or not. Father, Son, Mother, Spirit. A lot of Native Americans have that understanding. That's fine. Mother, Father, you know, ultimately is irrelevant, but it's fine. There's duality, positive and negative charge, male and female. It's fine. Light and dark, laughter and sorrow. Yes, absolutely. It's all part of this. Is the Matrix a mistake that God just doesn't know about? Absolutely not. He created this. This is for us. We are, you know, made in the image of the Almighty. I mean, that's our soul. You know, we are fearfully and wonderfully made, the Bible says. We must work out our salvation with fear and trembling, the Bible says. You know, we're here to be saved, the Bible says. We are here to go through this experience, the Bible says. We are here to overcome fear and anxiety about this world in Christ, because we have the Lord. But I use the Psalms for that, and they don't recognize. And from the line of David comes Jesus, Yeshua. Okay, there's just no question about that. And so those Psalms were inspired by Yeshua. You see, for us. And so I have no problem with the Old Testament or the Jewish Bible and the Gentile Bible or the New Testament, because all of the seed of Abraham who believe were united in Christ. And, you know, well, what about the Jews? Well, Jews or others, you know, the Bible talks about how the gospel went to the Gentiles and then it comes back to the Jews in the end, kind of like a circle. And that's been prophesied, and I have no reason to doubt that. So I have no anxiety about it. Do you? What about the Rothschild banking system? You know, those guys, they're all Satanists. There's the synagogue of Satan, Jesus called them. It's like, he wasn't referring to that. He's talking about people that are fake being the synagogue of Satan. And he didn't mean just the synagogue. He meant any religion, not just Jews. I can't get anywhere with people. They're so hung up on their logic and they're applying their logic. And you know, I've had people present to me things that are not logical. And you know, their theory about how it's all internal and it's all, you know, it's all going to be resolved internally and it's just a big internal, you know, salvation and Jesus comes to us in our minds and our hearts and that's the return of Christ and then we have this kumbaya moment and all that. It's like, sorry. But God is in the physical world. The interior and the exterior become the same, one and the same. And it's all connected. And you can't have one without the other. You don't go into the interior and forget the exterior, or exterior and forget the interior. And the funny thing is they go, you got to lose all your concept of structure and I subject-object relationship and all that. And you go, and then you find out that they're browbeating you and they're very didactic about this internal salvation through Jesus. That then changes us. And it's like, well, my friend, you don't look changed. So if that's your understanding and you've got Jesus, he's returned to you, then how come you're still the same old, you know, bag of tricks? How come you haven't changed? So you have an intellectual understanding and framework that just isn't based in reality. There's just no basis in reality because you prove there's no basis in reality. So therefore, I must depart. I must separate myself from that because I know it's not true. So I must walk away. A lot of times, people reject the exterior world and try to go with this interior fulfillment of all the prophecies and all this stuff, and that the real chosen of the Lord will go off with the Lord somehow, you know, probably after death, and have this great experience, or the New Jerusalem, or become, you know, beings of light, or whatever they're going to become, and it's totally bogus because, again, the Lord is not separate from His creation, and what I see. When I see the world and I see the earth and the clouds and the sun and the oceans and the fields of grass and whatever I see out there, I know the Lord is in that. And my thoughts and feelings, the Lord's in that too. I have a terrible time because, you know, I get the demonic realm bothering me, and I know there's been a lot of people who speak, you know, who have a similar phenomenon, but bothering me. And I have to fend them off at night and you know, during times where I feel bad about myself or whatever, you know, or if I do something wrong, then they try to come in to guilt and shame me. But they're always right there, just waiting to stab me with their pitchforks, waiting to start whispering in my ear and trying to get me to get under their control and trying to get me to go down that road that leads to death. And, you know, it leads to destruction, I should say, even a better term. And I don't know about you, but when it's at its height, you know, I always feel ashamed that I even, you know, I kick them out and kick them out. A lot of times it's better to just grab onto some scripture, get into the word, get into one of these podcasts, you know, do something right there rather than trying to, you know, to be passive, you know, get active at something. And no, it's a battle for every single person. I know there's been a lot of really, I was reading accounts of, it never used to happen to me the way it does today until it really kind of ramped up when I started doing the Zeph report. And then that, you know, would bring about of, you know, just, and lots of other things. But I mean, I know when it's the devil, they try to pass themselves off as, you know, the angels and God and all that, but we're not fooled because they are always carnal, right? It's always about, and if you have anything wrong with you, you know, well, the greatest door we can open is the door of pride. When we have pride, then they can just take us to town. They can just throw us off the cliff at that point. Or if we whatever kind of thing we're doing that's not right, that also helps them to come on in and try to make themselves comfortable. So we're continually casting that out. We're continually having to. The answer to that is to keep repenting, but to purification, spiritual purification is the way away from that, and I know this. And so whatever I'm doing to, you know, but we're not perfect, you know what I mean? You're going to have inadvertent doors open, and you have to battle it. When people say they don't need to battle anything, God's taking care of them. Red flag, those are the ones you worry about the most, because they're obviously completely mind-controlled. They're already taken to town. They've already got a hold of it. They're already controlling them. They're already possessed by the demonic. And if you're not possessed by the demonic realm, then you're fighting every day. Amen? For those of you. Well, once you get to be my age, you know, you understand it a lot better, you know. But when I was younger, I didn't. Younger meaning when I was 40, I didn't. When I was 45, I didn't, okay? When I was 50, I didn't. But then after 50, I started to understand. I can't beat myself up because I'm still intact. But, you know, the thing is there's a part of me that wants to destroy myself. And it's written in my DNA. It's inside me. And I got to battle that side of myself. And anyone who says they don't have a self-destructive, you know, force within them is lying, because every single being does. Right? It's the way God made things. It's the struggle. And if we're successful through this battle, The benefit is we escape the cube, escape the matrix, escape the Saturn, if you like, escape all that, escape the dualism, escape the contradiction, escape the what I call this is a it's a recycling of souls. Oh, it's not without the Lord's unction. I mean, it's not the Lord knows all about it. But I see the Lord fashioning souls here, fashioning. I see this as part of the Lord's creative process of making beings that are fearfully, wonderfully made in the image of God, ultimately, you know, that the fall and resurrection is all a part of the process. And so it's just, and when you see that you belong to him, and that means to all that is, you know, beyond, way beyond the bounds of this world, then this world, okay, and all the problems this world has, though they're very serious, and then we're called to different ways to deal with it, but it just is insignificant compared to the totality of all things, or to our real place in the universe with God. I mean, in the cosmos with God, okay. Compared to that, this world's really nothing. It's just a big test. But it's a serious test in that you can't get out unless you are saved. Otherwise, you'll just be recycled again. Like spin cycle. Yeah, you see the tunnel of light. You go see your relatives. You see the aliens are running it, right? The bug-eyed guys, yes. The little robotoid bug-eyed guys, they're there, helping facilitate it all. And you're not paying attention to that. You're paying attention to your loved ones and your dog, and all your memories seem to come to life, and you want to go into that tunnel of light and be with them all, and you don't want to return back to the realm of the living. And that's your experience. And of course, then you just get recycled. Gotcha. I've been shown that from the very beginning. It also ties together the Christian, you know, and Judeo-Christian and Islamic tradition, you know, Middle Eastern tradition, monotheism of Sumeria, of the Middle East, of you know, where monotheism was born, and the monism of Hinduism, and the escapism, if you will, the nihilism, yearning for nihilism, i.e. to end suffering, of Buddhism. It unites all the religions together under one roof. All the aspirations of these religions is to escape evil, to go with the Lord, to escape death and suffering. And of course, I'm not one that believes in reincarnation one-to-one necessarily, but I think it just kind of, it all gets recycled at the same, right? So you do see shades and colors of people that you've known before in new ones coming up, absolutely. And it's mysterious. Now, the Tibetans have made kind of a science of it, to where they feel they can identify the next Dalai Lama in the child, because they're looking for certain things. And, you know, the witches also have another method where they want to take those disincarnate spirits and reincarnate them themselves in babies by traumatizing them through satanic ritual and bringing that one that just died back into that baby so that they can obey that baby as their boss, as their leader. That's also been done for thousands of years. You know, it's a secret practice. I don't know why we know about it here. I guess, but the other things that is the bloodlines and the purification of the bloodlines to produce the ultimate, you know, Antichrist Messiah, if you will. But there would be a Messiah over, you know, a 3D existence, which is unacceptable to me. So I would never be impressed with that. My consciousness is at least four dimensions, five dimensions. Dreams are in the can be any kind of dimensional, and so, you know, I exist most of my life is not in a 3D situation. So, you know, being focused on that and being focused on vanity, being focused on time and space would not be, to me, would be just a cause of suffering. It wouldn't be a cause of liberation. So therefore, anything that would focus on that, a new world order, the Antichrist Messiah, whatever, all these concepts are irrelevant to me because I'm not interested. You know, there might have been a time thousands of years ago where I might have been interested in you know, ruling over the earth or something, but that it just seems when you see the big picture, it just doesn't, it kind of falls to the wayside. A lot of things have fallen to the wayside since, like, knowing the Lord and walking on that path. And one is the occult, having, you know, wanting to delve into the occult. The interest goes. I'm just not interested. I already know what's there. You know what I mean? I know it's the occult. And, you know, but I used to be. I would read Colin Wilson and, you know, all kinds of people that wrote about the occult. And, you know, I talked to people that I thought knew something in mystics and various people, and go to the Bodhi Tree bookstore in Los Angeles on Melrose there, and you know, pour through the books and you know, get all kinds of, you know, people having all their esoteric experiences and traveling in this spirit and all that. And I'm like, what about witchcraft 101 do you not know? Witches travel around and they can become like balls of light flying around. And sometimes you'll go, hey, a UFO, and it's really just witchcraft. You know, I mean, it's very powerful around here. The witches, especially on the reservations, on the pueblos, can shapeshift into like owls and, you know, ravens and things like that, and do in the sight of others. And it scares the hell out of them. But they'll turn into a bird and go fly somewhere. I mean, it's heavy. It's heavy duty. But see, it doesn't really interest me. I don't pursue it. I might have as a younger man in my 20s. But it's just like, what I have is so much greater than that, and so much more expansive than that, and so much more ultra-dimensional than that, that just is a little thing in, it's like comparison, it's nothing. It's not something you would pull off one thing to go focus on someone becoming a bird. That just wouldn't, it's so minuscule, as it would just be like, you know, having this beautiful vista, and then there's a gnat buzzing around you. So you go focus on the gnat and then really tune in and put it under a microscope, and then forget about the view of the Grand Canyon. You just want to look at the gnat. It's on that level. So, I mean, obviously, that's not something that interests me. And then, you know, interested in horoscope, like I had my chart done astrologically. I have no interest in that. I'm glad that was accurate. The Bible says that can be extremely accurate. God doesn't have to tell me to knock it off. It just gets knocked off. It's not like I'm saying, no, I won't do that. There's some people inviting me into a Ouija board thing on Google Plus. Well, I get this invitation to, tonight at 7, we're going to have the Ouija board going. I'm like, you people are insane. That is a great recipe for your own possession. Opening a door that you cannot close. I have respect for these powers because I've seen them at work. And it's like, you know, if the waves are 15 feet and closed out, and there are people out there wanting to surf it, that's their problem. I'm not going to go out there because I will get pummeled, because I respect the ocean. When there are size I think I can handle, then I like to go out and either body surf or surf or whatever it is I do. But I'm not going to go, you know, against something, a fight against nature, when I could be crushed. I'm not going to take a little barrel over Niagara Falls. You know, I'm just not going to do it. I have a lot more respect for the elements than that. And that's the same thing with the Ouija board. You open up doors that shouldn't be open. And the people that make the Ouija board have to, you know, I often wondered, I had one when I was a kid, you know. And I always got rid of it. It always made me nervous and uncomfortable. You know, I mean, it always got broken, or, you know what I mean? We weren't big Ouija people, me and my brother, you know. It just didn't interest us much, you know. So, but we had it, and it just didn't do any damage, because we were just drawn away. Let's say we were protected, you know, perhaps by angels. But the thing about it is it opens doors, and they wanted to invite me in on Google Plus. It's like, and I just was, I couldn't, I kept trying to figure out, how do I get rid of this invitation? How do I get rid of these people? You know? And I finally figured it out. Lately, someone's been, you know, messing with me in my email. They've been spamming the crap out of me with all these, you know, a million things. And I called Google, and they're on the case. You know, they're dealing with it now. And you know, I'm just wondering whether to keep my email or just go ahead and, you know, there's a way you can just get rid of it so that your email no longer exists. But then you have to sort of start over again and tell everybody you've been dealing, you know what I mean? That's, So you try to save it, but, you know, it's been, obviously, it's I'm on a list somewhere. That's what they were thinking, and it, you know, gets all this, like, feed burner, you know, subscription to this mag, that mag, hundreds of them, hundreds and hundreds of them. So I've set up the right filters, and, you know, so I don't see them anymore. It just takes 1 second to do that, and all kinds of things. So there are scams. I found out from, there's another one where they said, well, I have a Hilton Honors card because I've travel, and so you gain points. I think I'm at the gold level, and so you have an account there, and I can never remember my account number. I have a card somewhere, you know, in my wallet, but I got this note that says, oh, congrats, you know, your password's been changed at Hilton Honors, right? And so I'm like, it's been changed? I don't remember going there and changing it. So I call him up, and we go through it, and I get another password, which I've already forgotten, by the way. So I change it again the way I want. And then I realize that was just some kind of marketing thing to get me to call in. Yeah, nobody changed it because they can't change it unless they have your number. And they can't get the number unless they know specific questions, which they couldn't have known. So basically, bottom line is, I had to deal with them, and that I haven't dealt with them in a while, and that's, you know, I don't think that's a very good thing for them to do, but I mean, that's what they did. So, you know, it's a problem, you know, and I've thought, and if there's another email, I may eventually gravitate toward another email in time that is just more secure than that. But the point is, just like that's insecure and porous and its own security, you know, functions, the Ouija board, there is no security. You open yourself up to being demonically possessed and taken over. And if you're weak, these things can get a hold of you and keep you for years. They keep you. They control you. They steer you. And I know I've got to fight. Well, the alternative is if you do something like what I do, then you fight them off every day and every night. You're fighting them off. They're always there, and you're fighting them off. They're never not there. People that tell me, oh, I got the Holy Spirit, I don't have those kind of problems. Sorry. To me, that just means they are already possessed and they've lost. And they need help, but they're too proud to admit it, and so you just back away. People that come out of... most people that have, you know, danced with the devil and then they realize they have no power and they realize they're going down, they will convert to God because they know, they just instinctually know the jig is up. And in a way, it was almost good that they were over there for a while. They got their, you know, they were prodigal sons and daughters. The Lord loves these. These are given the best seat at the table. And it's okay if we've been plodding along and they come in lately. And they get the thing of them having made this conversion and it's all about them for a while. Fine, it doesn't matter to me because it's all about a bigger thing. It's beyond this time and space realm anyway. You know, it's just the Lord's going to get his harvest. And there's a lot of people that are turning to the Lord right now in America that, you know, otherwise would have been in... that have been successful in the world, but they realize there's something wrong, there's something missing. They're not, you know, they're the brunt of a joke somewhere. They don't realize that they're in prison and this their success is really a dream, kind of a dream state. And in a way, success without understanding of what success will give people is time, and time usually gives them grief, and grief, you know, will instruct them that, you know, success is not enough. Obviously, you know, being successful here is like being successful on the Titanic, making, you know, a model of a ship that's going to sail in the sea. You're making something that's irrelevant. Having a good career, having, you know, success, having, you know, done well here doesn't mean anything because the ship is ultimately sinking. I mean, it means something. It's good that you know, not to take away achievement for competing and working, but you know, it's like winning the Olympics. I was looking at a Bruce Jenner pole vaulting picture where he was pole vaulting, and you know, he had set the record for the pole vault, and it was a huge high, 15 plus feet, he had to pole vault. And I saw the picture of him getting over the top. And that was, to me, the most amazing, you know, this decathlon athletes. I mean, it's just an amazing thing. And, you know, so he won and had the box of Wheaties and everything, but, you know, and the rest of it, and then the Kardashian thing and the, you know, which I haven't really paid attention to. But he's had this whole kind of thing. And then the journey into the trans thing. I'm not going to say anything negative or positive about it. All I'm saying is, obviously, the pole vaulting, the success of the Olympics, didn't quite do it. And it can't. It's like this Titanic is sinking, and you win at shuffleboard. Well, great, but it doesn't do it for you. Or you win it being the rock star. Well, great, but it doesn't do it for you. Or you win the election. Well, great, but it doesn't do it for you. Because you're winning the election on the Titanic. Ultimately, it's going to sink anyway. And I think people are starting to get this. I don't know. Maybe I'm being too optimistic. God is not separate from politics. That's why a lot of politicians get prayer from me. Sometimes corrective prayer. As far as I can tell, seems like my prayers are working just fine. And, you know, it's like people say, well, I pray to God and that we can have more time and pray to God I can get my children through this and all that. But I'm not really political. I just stay out of all of it. It's like, well, then when they come to get you, then you have no excuse, do you? I know I swore I wouldn't get back into this, but I know that the world is not safe with these people that are in power now. And you can say, well, they're selected anyway. And I'm saying, well, there's another dynamic here. I mean, the last Congress was elected because people really are scared and they're fed up. And so they put Congress in. Then the Congress didn't do anything. They did exactly what the Democrat Congress did. You know, they didn't straighten the stuff out that they were sent there to straighten out, because there are people there already that were there to defend the president. Namely McConnell and Boehner and all that. So you go, see, I can't get involved in that. Well, I can, because see, I have prayer. I have a spiritual warrior here, me. What I intend and what I want to get done and what I'm led to do gets done. So yeah, it's unacceptable to me to have certain things in this country, and I can't just, and here I'm going to get to the nub of what the issue is with you. And, you know, we were, again, I'm going to go back to 2 Peter 2:9, because I just think maybe you didn't get this. And so I'm going to try to, you know, one more time. You know, it always hurts. It doesn't hurt to try. Okay. I'm in Romans 13. Yes. Yes, I was there. Okay. 2 Peter, which is 2. There's only 3 chapters in Peter, or 2 Peter. Okay, we'll go to 2:1. All right, so here's a verse the Lord gave me. The Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptations and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. And then it goes, because of this, though, and it's addressing lawlessness and people that are, you know, it parallels Romans 13. I'm not going to do that lesson today. I was going to do it, but it seems that the Lord didn't really want it out there the way I was doing it. So, the Lord deals with the just and the unjust alike. Okay, it's a balance there. And he says, you know, the unjust are going to be, you know, will be punished, but at the time of my choosing, that I know how to, and at the same time, he may have them in positions of power. But we are to honor the fact that the Lord is in this. I did do this with keep God in it. Okay, I did do this lesson. Okay, well, one more time. Okay. I can't really even remember what I did podcast-wise, sorry. We got into this a little bit. So the idea is that all the governments of the world and all the structure of the world and all the civilizations, you know, the Lord's in each one. So a solution is you're always going to have to go back to the source, to the Lord. And, you know, he doesn't have to explain to me why there's evil and why there's good. There's a balance, there's a balance or an imbalance in that area. But the Lord is still the one for the redress of these grievances. And so I've been praying, you know, for the right thing to be done with this country, and pleading because, number one, it's a very young country. Number two, I'm not going to get swept up in this. There's these hysterical Christians that are really giving themselves a very bad reputation, in my view, by spewing one false prophecy after another and saying, you know, they're making the same mistake that the Thessalonians did back in Paul's day, where they just kept waiting for the end, and, you know, and the end, as Frankie would say, you know, our troubles are over, the end has come, you know what I mean? It's like we can lay our burden down and go. And it's like, gosh, I'm disappointed every time. Rather than seeing what God is already doing, they keep expecting what God is going to do. And in so doing, they're cutting God out of the equation. They don't, I mean, not consciously, obviously. I'm not saying these are evil people. I'm just pointing them out a mistake that they're making. And so here's the thing. Here's what's on my plate today. Because every day is a different dream. Okay? So what's on my plate today is I've been involved in politics to a certain degree, national politics, which most people don't get involved with because they feel that it doesn't make any difference anyway. And the answer to that is, the devil is not God, you idiot. He's not God, and he never will be God. So don't tell me that. Do not tell me that my prayer, my intention doesn't mean something, because it does. And when I pray, things change. Like right now, everything's changed. But what I'm noticing is that as things change radically, we still get the same drumbeat of negativity from the alternative news media. Of we're marching toward, you know, whether it be Jade Helm or this or that or the other thing, or the comet coming on the 23rd or the blood moon or whatever it is. It's all over, folks. Prepare to die. It's all over, folks. But don't you realize that that's the enemy getting you to give up? Who would have a vest? Who benefits by you giving up and stopping praying? Because it's so bad that none of your prayers work anyway. It's going to happen anyway, whether you like it or not. Who has a vested interest in getting you to think in that horrible, horrible conundrum way? That's right, Satan. Because then you will not do anything about it. Now, those of you who receive the message of the faith increase here, you, I hope you really receive that and are running with it now, because I can see that some of you are, because I see a difference. Just like I saw a big difference after Govinda's podcast, where we did the one about his announcing the ending child trafficking and human trafficking by 2020. Let's give him 20 on 20, right? 20 minutes of prayer every 20th of the month to end human trafficking. And I noticed every time that 20th comes up, some huge pedophile ring or something gets busted. So I know the response of the world is legalize pedophilia. Then there's nothing to see here. Legalize human trafficking. Then there's nothing to see here. You can play that game for a while, but not forever. Because people are not going to want immoral laws passed. And pedophilia is immoral. In case you people have lost your way, pedophilia is immoral. It's immoral to take advantage of a child or to rob the innocence of a child in a way that's that would be traumatizing to that child. It's a sin to bring trauma to a children. Plus, most of these people, when they're indoctrinating the children to accept pedophilia, what they're doing is they're also indoctrinating them to reject God, to reject order, to become lawless, to join up with the collectivists, the communists. And the communists are the people that, were described in Proverbs 1. When I say communist, I mean collectivist. But let's just go ahead and go to Proverbs 1, because I think, you know, once again, this is one of the most important phrases of passages of the entire Bible. And, I even know people that have wanted to get rid of Solomon because they felt he had too much money, he was too decadent. It's like, there was a point to all that, but okay. The very first proverb. Where it says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. Okay, So they say, now look, if sinners entice thee, consent thou not. Now hear your teachers today. If they say, come with us, let us lay wait for blood, let us lurk privately for the innocent without cause, let us swallow them up alive as the grave and whole, as those that go down into the pit, we shall find all precious substance, we shall fill our houses with spoil, cast in they lot among us, and let us have one purse. Okay, that's the Satanist. Well, communism is just a political extension of the Satanism. It's all the same thing. It's Luciferianism, Satanism, collectivism. It's all the same. So you have a number of people on both sides of the aisle, politically, who are collectivists. They're in their secret societies, and they all have one purse, and they all back each other up. So they're publicly, they could be capitalist, or you know, they could be for democracy and for republic and all those things. But privately, they're not. They're collectivists, and they feel they are superior in their collective group because they have power in that group, and they're against all humanity, you know. So they lay wait. They have one purse, okay? And it says, my son, do not walk with them and refrain your foot from their path, because surely their feet run to evil and make haste to shed blood. Surely in vain the net is spread in the sight of any bird, and they lay wait for their own blood, and they lurk privily for their own lives. And throughout history, these same people who have tried through collectivism to get control of any economy, any government, anywhere in the world, have always failed, and their decadence has failed. So they try to indoctrinate the kids into collectivism in the way of and paganism, you know, collectivism, paganism, meaning, you know, a worship of the earth, a worship of the created rather than creator. They will instill in them any kind of deviance from whatever, you know, the norm would be, whether it be sexuality or anything else. They would teach it in such a way that, you know, basically the alternative is good, but the basic understanding is evil. The common sense thing is evil, but every alternative is fine, but just don't do that which is traditional or that which is in the Bible or that which, right? The Bible is evil, right? But what we say is good. Political correctness is good. Free thinking is evil. Well, you make up your own mind where you are. I'm just saying that's how they're indoctrinating the children. And, you know, you've got everyone from James Cameron making films like Avatar. And, you know, they're all doing the same thing to get this collective consciousness into this tethering or, like Invasion of the Body Snatchers is the best example. To be all conformed to the world, tethered to each other in a hive mind where there's no individuality. Everyone just thinks it's a hive. Thus, they are dead. There's no without being an individual, without being having free thought. You're not alive. You're like a robot. So that's what's being taught to the children: not free thinking, not thinking outside the box. And when people are taught to be like that, they don't invent anything. They don't come up with it. They just want to regulate and control the whole world, and ultimately take it down. And when they take down a state or a city or whatever, they actually move to another one that's more free, and they try to take that one down in the name of doing good. And they're always angry, and they're never happy, and you recognize them. If you say something they don't like, they fume as if you should be killed. Oh, I have pissed them off so bad at times. I don't do it on purpose, but it's just when I'm around them, I just start acting in such a way that I know they hate. Well, the one thing they hate is if you're on God's side of things, you know, which doesn't necessarily mean that you wear it on your sleeve. It's just you can see that, you know. And when you look like you're enjoying yourself and you could care less what they think, they go insane with anger, even if they're strangers. And that's when they manifest in that way, that's you can tell them by their manifestation. They're demonically possessed, numero uno. They're in the hive, collective. They're allowed to do some things, but not others. They've kind of made a living for themselves and boosted themselves above the other guy, and they want you to damn well acknowledge it and get on your knees, Because, you know, and you're not even in their hierarchy. You're not in their conformity. You're not in their hive. And you're just walking around having a good time. I can't stand that. So they, you know, persecute you. They'll cheat to get you and to throw you in the dungeon somewhere. Now you're going to pay. Now you're going to wish you had given more respect. Oh, yeah. Oh, I know them. I've sat there while they did it to me. While they pretended to be our friends and where they were putting the knife in. I've been through this a number of times. So I can tell you, I'm speaking from where I live here. But it's all part of the spiritual battle. In other words, if I go to be like them, I will be dead too. If I go to be like them, I may have talents and things I could really boost myself, but you know, it's all, you know, I'm a slave, so what good is it? If I'm in those circles, they tend to take free thinkers and people with talents and things. A lot of times they just sacrifice you. They give you drugs. They work it around so that you self-destruct. Because they're only interested in the mediocre norm in the middle. You know, the people that don't produce anything, they have no ideas. They're just followers. They're regulators. They're bureaucrats. And basically that's anyone who's special or has any kind of thing going on, they want to eliminate them anyway and just have this gross median point where everyone is obedient to the hive and nobody has a thing to say about anything. And you had quite a few people, not only as part of that, but promoting that through like music and things to be a part of something that is basically death for the human soul. So yeah, I think we have, you know, a few things to say here. You know, I've been observing this all my life. So I think, yeah, I have a couple things to say. First of all, I'm not going to stand by and watch this anymore. You know, it's not a matter of being wrong. It's a matter of being dead. And, you know, life is for the living. And I'm not going to consign myself to the realm of death just because people are telling me to. Well, you'd have to know what I'm talking about to understand, but I'm assuming that my audience understands. Certainly you're never going to get this on the terrestrial airwaves. Never. Because even intimating any of these things is crossing a line. And people just feel like it's like a chain letter. Out of fear, they send it on. What I do with chain letters, I take them and I throw them in the, you know, when they used to come. I throw them in the garbage and I just laugh at whoever, what an idiot that was that took part in that. And guess what? Nothing happened. But superstition, man joins these clubs because he's superstitious and he wants to better his advantage in the world and he doesn't want to be pummeled or hurt, so he'll go along with, you know, corrupting himself into some group or another and, you know, remain trapped there his whole life. And, you know, you think there's deathbed confessions everywhere? There aren't. Okay, so I'm in remembrance now we did this 2 Peter thing. Here's another proverb. Because I have called and you refused, I have stretched out my hand and no man regarded. But you have set at naught all my counsel and would none of my reproof. I also will laugh at your calamity. I will mock when you fear, when your fear cometh. When your fear cometh as desolation, and your destruction cometh as a whirlwind, when distress and anguish come upon you, then shall they call upon me, but I will not answer. They shall seek me early, but they shall not find me. Yes. The reason that's important, ladies and gentlemen, is because the time to seek the Lord and to relate and to be guided by and to just lay it all down, come on, lay it all down, is now while the Lord will respond. Because people that put this off and they keep trying to muddle through and they keep somehow thinking it's not going to wind up as a tragedy. And then they finally do want to repent at the last minute and they want to run after the Lord and he's not anywhere to be found. This happens many times in people's lives. The Lord knows when you've waited too long. The Lord knows when he's going to hide himself to make you work for it. And even then, it's because you refused the counsel, you refused the good word, you refused the guidance, you refused the wisdom. You did things in the sight of the Lord that you knew were wrong, and now suddenly you want the Lord because things have turned on you, and he's nowhere to be found, and you're desolate. This is an age-old lesson, one that goes back, you know, thousands of years. My advice would be to just go with the Lord, however you are. No, don't get cleaned up first and then go to the Lord. Go to the Lord and let the Lord clean you up. Well, so many people said, don't do this and don't do that. And I found that when I'm with the Lord that I naturally don't do this and don't do that. It's kind of that rather than someone telling me, you know, browbeating me. And that's the objection I had with the church. I realized if you're really with the Lord, you do clean things up. I mean, you're not ever going to get rid of, and I don't, you know, paint no panacea here. You will never get rid of this idea that you're fighting, you know, good and evil and temptation in your life and all that. Now, 2 Peter, it says, the Lord knows how to lead a person through temptation. You're going to have some temptation because if you don't, you atrophy spiritually. And you're going to give in every once in a while to temptation. You're going to hate yourself for it, but you're going to repent unto the Lord, not unto yourselves. And in so doing, you'll be strengthened. I don't think the Lord expects perfection of us, but I think he does expect us to fight against sin. That doesn't mean that, you know, you're going to be 100% successful. And if I were to sit here and say you should be, then that will make you feel like a total failure when you obviously fail, because we do fail. We break down. We're tired and we can't fight back. And then we think we're serving the Lord when we're really serving ourselves. All kinds of things like that happen. We give in to pride, lust, all kinds of things. The key is, you know, a lot of people, they go, I broke the rules, that's it, I'll never get back with God. It's like, no, you stumbled and you repented and you're right with God, and you know, you're going to struggle against that thing, whatever it is in you that you've got, and you know, you're going to overcome. But the thing not to do is, well, I was just born this way, I guess I just can't do anything about it, so I'm just going to stumble along the path I'm on. Wrong, because that's the epic fail path. That makes your life worse. I see people I used to know. That's bringing on some. I see them, you know, online you can see people in their lives, you know, not that I go looking or snooping, but, you know, I see people from, you know, high school, or people I knew as a young adult, or, you know, just along the way. And many, many are not here anymore, you know, which is what happens when you get up and, well, you know, Roddy Piper, he was my age, right? 61. No longer with us. You know, God rest his soul. Did a lot of good in this world, just in his little way. You know, it's had quite an impact, right? In waking people up. You know, that was the first Matrix movie, right? And you know, they're gone. He's gone, you know. And there was a guy commenting yesterday who was just saying, well, there's something up with that. It's like, I could just go. You know, I was thinking about that yesterday. It's like, you know, I pushed myself. I could go. You know, I'm not taking it easy. I could if I wanted to, but I don't. It's just not the way I roll. My whole life, I've never taken it easy. I've been a kind of a free spirit and done my own thing, but I don't take it easy. I like working. If the Lord doesn't, you know, my philosophy on work is the same as Paul's. It's like, if you don't work, you don't eat. And so if you're in a position to choose whatever you want to work at, well, then if you don't work, you don't eat, then work at it. There's so many people that I run into that if they get any way, shape, or form of just getting, if they have any kind of a cushion where they can just not do anything, they actually just veg. Now, I'm not criticizing. No, I'm not, you know, I'm just saying, you know, that's why you're in a structured job, that you need to be there and you have a boss, because if you didn't have that boss, if you're on your own, we know you're going to be on the couch. Okay? So you're at work. So that's a good thing. God's keeping you. If you don't work, it's really, we're here to, if you have an abundance of crops or you own cattle or you have, you know, an income, you're still expected to work. You know, you're managing your resources, but it's you have income coming in from those resources that puts you in a position of having some free time. Then work at studying something, work at doing something. Then you have to work at something, work at a charity thing, work at helping children, work at, you know, put your back into something. Now help houses for Habitat for Humanity or whatever, you know, anything. It's just you've got to do something. And the Lord, you know, I try to pay attention to wherever He wants me. But there's times I'm so tired that because I'm kind of on call here, you know. So when something hits, I got to jump on it, no matter what time, day or night. And then I have the studio, which is hard. And at times where my back really hurts because I'm leaning and I'm patching cables in and I'm doing, you know, and then I'm also tired, fighting fatigue. And I just say, Lord, I'm, you know, wow, I really better, you know, mend up here. I kind of feel like I'm playing injured here. He doesn't care. He goes, yeah, that's a good day at work. You know, in other words, that's, you know, so whatever it is you work at. Just like I've got here guys that come out and work and they you know, try to keep the place and, you know, from all the desert from encroaching on us. And they work and they like it. And they were telling me, this one guy that's, he's a citizen here. He did it all the right way. He came from Mexico. And he tells me the guys coming across right now, the problem you have is that the immigrants coming in right now don't want to work. And that's like the majority. He says, they come over all day long and they just want to be on the dole. They want the food stamps, they want the benefits, but they don't want to actually work. And the government set it up that way. So that's something that needs to be changed. They come here and so they have free time on their hands because obviously they're being paid for. But instead of using it to, you know, to better their community, to go work on something, to offer themselves up for a job, they're not looking for jobs. They just consume. And the Lord will never abide that. Now, I know they're doing it for a political purpose, to overwhelm the system, Clarence Piven, overthrow the United States, whatever, you know, by flooding with immigrants, give them everything they want. People, they're getting more benefits than people who have been here all their lives working and working hard and working at, you know, multiple jobs. And these people are getting the same benefits as them, even more. Like they're getting free cars in some cases, free, you know, apartments with big screen TVs, air conditioning, you know, free cell phones and, you know, all kinds of school stuff for their kids. And, you know, as if they've been not even what the people here are working their butts off for, they're not getting all that. But the immigrants, so it's a crooked thing, is my point. Hello, Dasha. That's a good girl. Okay. Oh, she's a good girl. She's a really, really powerful, strong now. And she's, the thing I like about her is that, you know, it's the loyal dog. She stays wherever I am, you know, or Trish, whatever, she stays with us. And same thing if I let her out at the, I'm having to kind of do some restoration on my truck because it's you know, it's a few years old. I finally got paid it off. So it's mine now. And that falls apart. You know, everybody, that happens, right? So I'm getting it fixed up and I only had one leash. So I let Dasha out. It's a busy dealership. It's a big, Coors Avenue out there in Albuquerque. I let her out, and I've got Eli on a leash, but she was, you know, she just stays right there, not distracted, but cars everywhere, you know, in the service department. And we just went back to the to Trish in the Jeep, and she got right in. That's what I'm talking about, you know, that kind of thing. I really, you know, need that. So that way I can have her around at lots of applications, let's put it that way. You know. Okay, so the point is what we really have to do is we really have to live lives, okay, that are reflecting, you know, the spirit of Christ, obviously, but the spirit of God, in the sense that we can't be pummeled on a daily basis by the evils in the world that are so terrible, and we get our conspiracy theory news, and we find out they're sacrificing children, or they're doing some horrible thing, or they're passing laws to take all your guns and your property and everything else. Yes, it's going on. Their diseases are coming, or whatever it is. That is the hurdle we must overcome in order to please God, in order to be reverent of God, I will put it that way. In order to worship God, we must not be beleaguered by those things. If we are, we're not in concert with God. We're not worshiping God. We're not connected with God. We're not in Christ. We're outside. Technically, it doesn't mean you're not saved. It just means you're operating outside the will of God or outside the relationship with God. Because if you have that relationship, you're not bogged down. Everything is, every moment is just a wonderful blessing, and you're throwing yourself into trying to make the world a better place, to bring the Lord, to bring love, to bring Christ, to bring respect, to bring good things to the world, to help heal the world and all that. You may give yourself to that. Or the Lord may have you doing some, you know, task that is compartmentalized, so you don't know how you're helping the world, but you are. But you can't be bummed out. I think that's a good colloquialism, bummed out. You can't be bummed out by this, by the horrors of this world. You must be a beacon of hope to others who are bummed out, who are in deep sorrow, who are dysfunctional, who need help, who are on drugs or they're in things that, you know, you've got to be some kind of hope. And you can't be that if you're just crying every day. And you can't be that if you're just bummed out every day. And you can't be that if you're just complaining every day, all day long about, that was the whole thing that we tried to do with 2 Peter, basically railing against dignities while cutting God out of the equation, complaining about the powers that be, and having no God in your life, not trusting him to straighten it out, not having enough faith that your prayers matter, just saying, it's the same old, same old. No one can make any difference. It's all rigged anyway. The whole thing sucks. The whole New World Order is coming to get us. Nothing you can do about it. Just sit there and be happy. But they're not happy. If they were happy in the midst of that, they would be getting an A plus from the Lord in the graduate school of spiritual warfare. But we're not getting that. We're getting beaten up every single day. We are standing out there. We're seeing Barack Obama do something, or seeing somebody do something with the Iran deal or something like that. And we see it all tying into the New World Order and this new trade agreement and the rest of it. And we're bummed out. We see the debates and we're bummed out. You see, to the pure, all things are pure, but we're not pure anymore. We've lost our innocence. So there isn't, you know, I know you're not going to go to the Super Bowl, and you're not going to go to that rock concert, and you're not going to trust that movie, you're not going to, but there's just nothing, because the whole thing is a sham, all of it. Because it's all jaded. It's all cynical. None of it matters. Now, I can tell you what kind of person that is. First of all, that was a person that used to be, obviously, pure, and their heart was broken. But they're no good in this world, because they don't work at anything. You know, I mean, the best work you could do would be to show Christ, right? I mean, that's work. They're not working at trying to make this a better place. They're not working at putting their prayer on the line. They're not working at developing their faith. They're not working at something they feel the Lord might want them to work at by inquiring of the Lord and then being led to that, you know, to wherever it is. They're just basically there in their armchairs complaining about all the bad stuff that's going on. And I just have to tell you, I really have, this is really what's on the Lord's heart today. And basically what's being told to you is that if you want to serve the Lord, then you must do so with a bounce in your step. You must be of good cheer because Jesus Christ has overcome the world. Therefore, in him, you've overcome. Now, doesn't that make you feel better? But the world's in sorrow. Therefore, I'm in sorrow. Yes, well, Jesus is a man of sorrow, but he was also a man of joy. And he is a God of joy. He is the Alpha, the Omega, which is joy, the first and the last, which is joy. Be of good cheer because he has overcome the world, which is joy. He has rescued all of you, which is joy. He has made you a royal priesthood, which is joy. You're to be joint heirs of the entire cosmos, which is joy. You already are. You're ambassadors of Christ, which is joy. You're not tethered to this world. And to where it really makes a lot of difference whether you're a king or a pauper, a rock star or a loser. All those terms are now irrelevant in your life. You can buck it up. You can feel good about yourself because there's no standard except for the Lord that could judge you against something else. So there's no standard like being first in the class, being the best marksman on the battlefield, winning this contest or that contest. All are now irrelevant. The pressure is off. You could be happy. You could be happy. You could be happy. You're just not going to put up with me being on the air today, are you, Miss Dasha? Huh? You're not going to put up with it. Give me that paw. That's a good girl. Well, I got news for you. We have to be happy. We have to be. Well, I'll tell you something. I know I'm happy if I'm creating something, and I'm, you know, even if it's hard. And I'm not happy if I'm not creating something. Okay, so if I'm, you know, making a music track, which is hard work, actually, you know, to do it right and everything. I have a lot of joy. And it may be, you know, maybe taking a toll or, you know, well, this takes a toll because I'm always fighting the rest, right? But I'm basically, when I'm talking to you, I'm really happy. And the reason I'm happy is because I'm just so thrilled to be able to have this conversation with you. Yes, it is a conversation. It is going back and forth, whether you realize it or not. But I'm so grateful that I have something I can do, that I can talk to you in the hopes that the Lord would use this in some way to reach out to help not only you, but help us both. And I feel the Lord's presence right now. And so I feel like, I mean, all the cliches, if God's for us, who could be against us? If the Lord's here with us, what could be wrong? You know, if death is what he's going to come, let it come. If life, let it come. If success, let it come. If failure, let it come, whatever. It's, you know, there is no failure, though, ultimately in God. I know that at the end of the day, whether I abase or I abound, that at the end of the day, I still have the Lord. It's the same in the Lord, whatever. And we've been bounced around up and down and had the Lord in both situations. So it's not that much different when things are good as when things are perilous. We still have to find that joy in the Lord regardless. You say, well, aren't you what about if you drink too much? Well, obviously, we've got to work on that, but what if you cuss too much? Well, obviously, got to work on thought, word, and deed, yes. You see, it's not going to take away the fact that I'm a sinner. You know, that I may recognize the body as a temple, and I may have trashed it. That I might clean it up, then it might get trashed again. But I can't run away and hide from the Lord. I just can't do it. Because I need to have a source of joy. And you know what? Humanity isn't it right now. The world doesn't give me much in the way of joy. Because people are so busy doing each other in these days that it's just, it's horrible. It's just a horrible nightmare. It's like a horror movie every day. So I must find my solace. And in solace, find peace. And in peace, find happiness. And in happiness, be content and be at rest because of the Lord Jesus Christ, because of the Lord God Almighty, because of Yahweh Elohim, the one true God. Knowing that He's there, knowing that my prayers matter. So therefore, of course, careful what you pray for. But knowing you have that power is something. And because of those things, and because I know that I can, you know, be a positive influence on the world because of that, much to the protestations of those working evil, of course, I have a sense of purpose or contentment that shouldn't be any different here as out in the cosmos somewhere, whether in outer space or here, or an eternal body, or not. It shouldn't matter on the joy factor. It should still be the same contentment in all configurations, in all dimensions, in all dreams. So I do have this sense. At the same time, I'm not happy about things that I need to work on. But I'm going to work on them, and you know, because I don't like going one step forward and two steps back and two steps forward and one step back. I don't like that, but it seems that's the way it goes, whether I like it or not. But then again, that's part of the work we're all given, right? To struggle against those things while we're doing other things that could be construed as work. Because, you know, and while we're being obedient to the Lord, you know, while all that's going on, so it's all in concert. And when it's all in concert, then you have a harmonious society. Right now, the balance is tipped in the favor of evil, yes. But I can see that the pendulum is swinging the other way at long last. And any extreme to either side, whether it be the left or the right, which is all we have in this world, the left or the right, which is all we really have, you know. And but no matter what extreme, I see equilibrium coming back into nature. I see the Lord having the hearts and minds. I see that whatever you would pray for, you could have an influence on. I can only tell you about whatever you do with politics is up to you, but I don't see God separate from politics, from going down to the grocery store, from being contemplative in my little room and in prayer. I don't see God separate from any aspect of life. If sometimes we have to do things we don't want to do, and when the shift becomes to the Lord, you know, all right, I'll do it for you, God. It could be some menial task. It could be driving a forklift at Home Depot, whatever. You know, it's I'll do it for you, Lord. Now, why? Because then the joy comes back in. The resentment goes and the joy comes in. So somehow I think we've gotten on the wrong track. We think we're serving the Lord by scaring each other to death with these prophecies of horrors to come. They're on the books and planned. Yes, well, we know those books are very old, and they've been on the books and planned for a long, long time. Why don't we now go ahead and trust the Lord? Well, because now, once we take our eye off the ball, that's when all hell's going to break loose. Well, if it does, it does. If it doesn't, it doesn't. What if I were to tell you that there would be another generation and ours will pass? And then there'll be the young ones coming up and they're going to have a world to live in. No, the end time should have happened by then. What if I told you the next generation will be brought up? I'm not saying, why can't we treat it like that? Rather than, oh, they're a doomed generation, we're all going down. How much time do we got? No, a couple years, 3 years. Well, then in that case, that's a lot of time. You could do a lot of things in that period of time. But what they're doing is they're waiting out there. They're waiting for someone to lead the charge. So, but let's not forget that there are things out there. You've got Planet X, World War III, nuclear war, Ebola war, plagues and awful things. You've got the Pale Horse. You've got plans of genocide, of depopulation, of a new world order. You've got evil, the Vatican, the Jews, the bankers, the armies of the world that are under control of Spectre, evil. The fact that everything you see on television or anywhere else is tainted now and jaded, and kids 8 years old are jaded and faded and tainted. Innocence is stolen at 5 years old now. Maybe it would be great if we could take it at 3 or 2. Well, the funny thing about me is my innocence was stolen, but then I created my own fairy tale as a survival mechanism. So I had an extended childhood. Well, don't hurt a child, because you know that it comes back to bite our civil society. The jails are filled with people who shouldn't be there. We've killed 60 million babies by murder, justifying abortion. And boy, that's up for political debate this time. So I am kind of involved in the political arena. There's two people that I liked. And I was, one, I was an early supporter of Carly Fiorina, and two, Donald Trump. It's funny how both of these people won the respective debates. And Carly, that went from no one to someone. Well, I was impressed many months ago when a trip, either going to Durango or back from Durango. And I remember we were in the RV. And she came on the airwave, and it was like a show, like an ABC thing or something, and she started talking. And I was just, impressed. I already knew her from back in the day where she was running Hewlett Packard, so I was very familiar with her already. And I knew that, the failure of, all the dot-coms and the tech sector back when it failed in 2000, 2001, it wasn't her. It was 15 years ago, but it had nothing. They all went the same way, and they tried to blame her for it. It's not true. But now you hear echoes of, Iron Lady, Margaret Thatcher, all this stuff. Oh, I know on the conspiracy news that all these people are bad. Ronald Reagan's bad. They're all bad. They're all, Satanists, pedophiles. They all drink blood from cups. They all hang out. No, there's no cohesion in all that. People are corrupt. And so they're going to say things like that to get you to say, oh, well, I'm not going to participate. It all sucks. It's all evil. And so you believe that rhetoric, and then you do nothing, which is what they want. Anyway, so I was praying for some relief for the country. The Lord brings us Donald Trump and Carly Fiorina, as you know, and the last night, it's so funny, they've made the same mistake again. I got to, for the, any of those of you who are watching the debate, I've had so much joy out of Donald Trump, I can't tell you, you know. I feel like even if his run is, I mean, I don't know what the Lord's going to do. I can't tell you what he's going to do. I can say this. The Lord lifts up the foolish things to confound the wise, and that's exactly what they've done with him. And the last shall be first, and that's what's happening with Carly Fiorina. And yes, with leadership like that, we could turn some things around. Yes, I would hope so. But this idea that we've had the last 8 years, or the last 6.5 years, people have just thrown their hands up and said, go ahead, rape me, Obama, do whatever you want. You know, I'm with, and then they've told me, I'm with the Lord, I don't care what happens here. Well, that kind of attitude will get you put in a concentration camp, probably, where had you had a different attitude, you might not be. Had you prayed, you might not be. Had you worked at it, you might not be. But instead, you knew it was all rigged, and you, boy, I'll tell you, and you cut God out, you cut everything out, you cut away the possibility of you praying about things that you obviously can't change, and you gave man all the power, took away, and you gelded God. Because you have no faith. You say you do, but you don't. I'm not saying become a political person just because. I'm just saying God's not separate from politics or from any aspect of life. So you make your own decision of how you're going to, you know, deal with the Lord, but don't cut him out. Don't just go say, well, you know, the Lord's really doing this, and, you know, this is all irrelevant what happens on the surface of the earth. No, it's not irrelevant. It's God's earth. And if you say it's irrelevant, you're saying he's irrelevant, and he is not. Now, Paul had the same struggle with people back in those days, especially the Thessalonians, because they were just going to wait for Jesus. He's coming, and they're not going to work. This is what they would do. They just quit working, and they just waited for the end. He said, that's just not the way it's going to be. So be prepared in your hearts. Be like the five wise virgins as opposed to the, you know, five foolish. You know, be prepared, be ready. But you keep at the task the Lord has. He just won't let us have a time of not, you know, working at something. Look, for some people, it doesn't mean employment with a job somewhere. It's it could mean just standing outside, you know, standing somewhere they can see you because you have the light of Christ. You know, it may be handing out. I don't know what it is. I know one guy in Albuquerque used to be down there. He would stand there with his cross in the middle of the road. That was work. It takes work to be out there on a sweltering day with your cross, subject to public ridicule. And he took it, and he'd be there all day long. No effort is invalid, and none of these efforts come back void. They all... Anything that has to do in concert with God is going to be, it's going to bear fruit. But you see, if they can convince us that it's all rigged and we shouldn't do anything anyway, then it puts us in the category of just getting through the day. What they're really afraid of is a praying church. You know, a praying ecclesia, a praying gathering under Jesus Christ, a praying group. They're afraid of your prayers, especially the name Jesus Christ, Jesus, Yeshua. That name, above all other names, but that name scares the hell out of them because they know that there's power in that name. There's power on it. I mean, you can pray in Jesus' name even if you're a non-believer and things will happen. And with that, I bid you shalom. I hope and I pray this was of a benefit. I, you know, just let it be a check when, you know, someone's got to say this today. There has to be a check. Okay. Till next time, shalom, shalom, shalom. Love you and praying for you. And I'll see you next time.